Professor Bruno Basso, and I thank him a lot for having accepted our invitation. Bruno is a Michigan State University Foundation professor in the Department of Plant, Soil, and Microbial Sciences at Michigan State University, and he's a pioneer in the use of digital agriculture technologies. And his talk will be about pathways to sustainability with digital agriculture towards carbon negative crop production. The floor is yours, Bruno.
Okay. Can you see my screen and hear me okay?
Everything is perfect. Go ahead.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to have the opportunity to present some of the latest work that my lab and colleagues in this field have been doing. Digital agriculture plays a critical role when it comes to design, but also one of the major questions is how we scale technologies, how we scale sustainable agriculture such that we can have a carbon negative farming system. And I have to start with some of the challenges that probably you may have heard already. So I'll be really quick, but it's just of paramount importance to understand the threat that we have. We have to feed more people, even though we've been doing that at a rate, you know, yields complete to go up in some places, but in others are stagnated or going basically not growing because of various reasons, and majorly affected by climate, less water, and in a changing climate. One additional component is that we still waste a significant amount of food. 70% of the water that we use is used in agriculture, which basically poses a significant threat for the future in terms of expanding more land with less water available. Now, the figures below are just really quick snapshot of what is happening in the context of agriculture in the sense of indirect land use. So we're losing some of the best land, especially in the US, but in many other places, because of this urban sprawl. And so cities come basically invading this very fertile soil. The city of Houston has about 5% organic matter outside, and the city keeps basically taking this land away. We have deforestation that continues to occur. You can see that pretty dramatic picture, both the Amazon, Southeast Asia, and many other places. So lose land by fires, land degradation. We lose about a pound of soil, which is half kilogram, for every bushel of corn that is produced in the US Midwest. And a bushel is roughly about 60 kilograms. So it's a significant amount of soil, topsoil, which means obviously fertility, soil organic carbon, and so on. And then water quality. A few years ago, even in the area exactly where I'm located in the region of the Great Lakes, that's the kind of images that some of these lakes, because of eutrophication due to excess amount of fertilizer, both nitrogen and phosphorus. Now, curbing the emission is mandatory. We need to avoid warming, and the animation here shows at the current rate, we have about 6 years and 8 months, 16 days or so before we reach 1.5 scenario of warming, and we have 24 years before we get to 2 degrees. Well, those are pretty, you know, serious and threatening type of, you know, images, because again, the thresholds and the tipping point and the planetary boundaries will be further exacerbated under these threats with more extreme events. It's not just about increasing temperature. As you know, this is also pretty well accepted by the majority of, you know, obviously all the scientists, that warming is occurring, both if you see the line going on the global, but it is very important to pay attention to what happens. So this is temperature compared to a baseline of 1950 to 1980. And so in the 90s, starting from the 90s and 2000, as you before saw several blue colors, there isn't a single blue color happening. And it's basically all pretty dire, dark red occurring. And this is on a global scale. Some places have already gone over 1.5 degrees as hotspot. In addition to the temperature, we have had increases in precipitation, both amount as well as intensity of the rain. The Midwest is receiving significant amount of greater rain, which causes is not always positive. We have often the opposite problem. We got too much water that we need to get rid of. And even though they are benefiting from a longer season, because you have less, plus frost-free days. So you basically could gain up to, a week or more, but that requires adaptation. So I'll be talking about that, how important it is to link agronomics with genetics in order to adapt. The agriculture is not new to challenges. I've put it all together here. We know that these are some of the breakthroughs that we had. And each of the breakthroughs, unfortunately, came with a level of, major environmental disaster. We had the introduction of mechanization really allowed us to start producing food to feed the growing population. But at the consequences of a dust bowl, we basically lost all the topsoils of the prairies all the way that the soil reached Washington, D.C., and that's when Roosevelt started the Soil Conservation Service. After that, the introduction of fertilizer and agrochemicals have allowed basically the Green Revolution be able to have, improved genetics that were responsive to fertilizer and technologies to be able to have graded yields and feed. Obviously, Norman Borlaug received a Nobel Peace Prize for that. So that led to going from some conventional level of breeding to an incredible, biotechnology breakthrough, now all the way to gene editing. And so extremely powerful and important. And so there is a bright future in that context. But doing things in the laboratory can only go so far. They have obviously to be tested in the fields, and field is dominated by uncertainties, by different climate, soils, interaction with the agronomic management. And so that's where data, collecting information over space and time. And so in the last basically 10 years, we've been witnessing data science and modeling, satellite, drones, data analytic. Obviously, the omic sciences continue to advance quickly. Microbiomes, both soils and plants. And so, what is coming? It's basically digital twins, basically reproduction through artificial intelligence. Even in agriculture, there is a major constraint that you'll see a little bit more. That agriculture is often probably erroneously confused with a big data. Genetics generates a significant amount of data, but the observation in the field are limited. So AI may have not all the possibility, but there are way to do it if we link to crop simulation model, validated crop models, and then AI will have additional data to be trained on. So a digital twin is simply a bridge between the physical and the digital world to promote innovation and performance, to go all the way to a circular bioeconomy. A crop simulation model fits the definition of a digital twin. We grow plants on the computer, be able to understand the genetic traits and be able to quantify all the different processes that occur in the soil, both from soil water balance, soil carbon, greenhouse gas emissions, prolificacy or barrenness in new traits of cultivars. And so there's been quite a bit of advancement in simulation modeling linked to biogeochemical model, all the way to basically have a cloud-based analytics where the farm is completely digitized. And Now, these are, as anything that comes as new, there are early adopters in all the way in implementing changes. But in the research domain, there is a significant amount of interest from funding agency to be able to link artificial intelligence and digitalization with agronomics and genetics. The one of the critical thing, again, that the agencies, the funding agencies in the US, the National Science Foundation, DOE, NIH, or USDA, have this common goal of one health. So the healthy ecosystem lead with soil and water. You can read soil carbon sequestration. Healthy ecosystem lead to healthier food, healthier farmer, healthier communities. There is much more demand from the consumers to basically generate improved products and traceability. How was it produced? Even by accounting for biodiversity threats or civil rights, did we exploit resources? And so I'm heavily involved in the sustainability of food companies as well as big pharmaceutical in the context of agriculture. So there is quite a bit of sensitivity on sustainability agenda. So that's, I guess, is a very promising thing. In addition to having now voluntary, but potentially becoming mandatory soon. So Michigan State, I co-lead Regenerative Ag Center, highly funded by USDA, as well as matching fund from different food companies. The agriculture is witnessing for the last, I would say, 20 years or more in terms of, it was even earlier, but the quality of the data wasn't as important, I mean, as a good quality. This occurred thing because the military allowed us to put GPS on tractor and be able to be used for civilian use. They removed the delusion of precision. So before it wasn't possible to know the exact location. But there is a revolution, and as you probably know, agriculture is often in the media to be able to link, again, you know, food quality, food production, food security with sustainability, all the way, not necessarily to show off here, but to be able to have, you know, an editorial on Forbes, which is never necessarily paid any level of attention to agriculture. And so this level of technology is becoming much more integrated on the farm. For example, I mean, we've seen robotics, they're becoming much more on the commercial side, you know, drones are spraying, there are commercial application already, but even this center pivot that can apply water every single row of maize. So the other thing is, this is cover of are basically an NDVI images on a weekly basis of our planet, you know, basically breathing and dying on a yearly basis. You can see the movement, and we've been doing that for a long time, but this is a high resolution, obviously, to be shown at a global scale. But we have now gone into the possibility of monitoring. These are daily images. There are 1,200 images in this slide. 1,200 photographs, snapshots at 3 meter resolution. So there's very little that we can't see from the sky, and be able to have additional ground truthing and linking that with crop, again, simulation system of different sorts is critical. The other critical piece is the geospatial sensing. And so one of the things that farmers mostly associate with is the possibility of monitoring this yield across. So this is a measured yield maps at every 2 square meter, where basically it's recorded across. And you can see how much variability. So 68% of the US corn is harvested with this level of machinery, 45%. So half, 45 million acres are mapped. And the problem is very little is implemented in variable lake. We define one of the most critical layer, this yield stability. When you have 15 years, 20 years of yield monitor, farmers tend to have a short memory of what happened, and they can't visually integrate all these images. So if you start, we develop this procedure that you basically look at how different one pixel is from the neighbor and how different the pixel is from over time. And so you'll see areas that they are constantly having high yields versus area that they're constantly underperforming, or areas that they fluctuate from 1 year is good, then 2 years in a row can be bad, or vice versa. So we can't depend on yield mapping from farmers. So I personally scale with several, you know, publication to be evaluated for, if you have interest, is basically you can now, through remote sensing imagery, you can now click on any single field and be able to get a yield stability map. Having the common land unit across all these, with US is a very data rich, Europe also, so this could something be reproduced in Europe. And so we learned that 48% of within field is constantly high yielding, 25% is always underperforming, having leading to nitrogen use efficiency, obviously all the other resource use efficiency. And then unstable is 27%. With we did a mass balance with very heavy impact on CO2, energy, economics, and fertilizer. And we matched the number of the amount of fertilizer that ends up in the Mississippi River. The big difference is now we know where it comes from. The sad news is that 25% of the land causes 85% of the pollution. The other thing is we were able to quantify at scale areas within a field where they're more vulnerable to water deficit or excess water. This is a typical image for people that have spent time in the Midwest that you will see every at the end of the spring. You can clearly see, imagine that the yield of this field is not going to be uniform. And so understanding both, again, this stability of yields and trying to match that and position in the landscape is a critical thing that we've been helping farmers with. And so these are the share of the cropland that is more prone to excess water versus water deficit and hilltop. So once we know that where this land land is located, where how contiguous these pixels are, these are the low yielding areas across 80 million acres. So if we were to implement some action, some level of alternative management, we will have significant amount of benefits. And obviously, we can propose this kind of thing in terms of policy or incentives, and farmers will need to adopt. But on the analysis, you'll see immediately you have nitrate leaching reduction, because you clearly see, you clearly understand that you're not putting as much nitrogen, since if for the last 10 years, your dislocation has not been giving you a yield more than 5 tons. You knew it wasn't nitrogen when the rest of the field could have been at 12 with the same amount of nitrogen if it is low and stable. And these are only the low and stable areas. So you can sequester more carbon, you can have biodiversity benefit. So what are some of the implementation that we can do? The first one, I was invited to write this basically news views of precision conservation. And so the maps and the analysis is immediately to get the attention from any producer is a profitability map, because it's, we know pretty well the cost of production. There is no secret, as long as we understand the management, which is also relatively predictable. I mean, especially across the states, we know how much nitrogen is applied, you know, some typical field of Iowa versus Michigan or, you know, Missouri and so on. So the areas where they understand that they're losing money on some of these areas. The variable rate technology allows, again, understanding where you could have basically a response, and then you go with optimal fertilizer, because we need to continue to produce the yield and continue to feed the world or whatever other use this system have been allocated to. So in the other areas, we can plant pollinators. So this is a project that we recently got funded, where we incentivize the removal of the low and stable zones in basically by planting prairie strip and pollinators. And so you have spillover effects, you have a lot of benefits. But the greatest thing is that the food companies are, and you know, embracing that, because it incentivizes, you know, carbon sequestration, because you have perennial plants, you know, deeper roots, and you sequester more carbon, and you can both receive the incentives for production as well as production in terms of the areas next to are produced where biodiversity is present, as well as carbon credits. And so this is an example. We send out prescription of precision conservation. We monitor them, and this is really resonating to the farmers. The power of the modeling allows us to run scenarios. And so these are changes in soil organic carbon, including all the zones together. And so if we continue to do conventional tillage and plowing, we will continue to lose about close to 400 kg per hectare per year of soil carbon versus no-till and cover crop, which are leading towards a sequestration of just organic carbon, which is about 1200 CO2 equivalent. So the carbon is between 300 and 400. So one of the examples, last year we sent 25,000 acres of prescription mat. This is some of the fields. You have an imagery within season to move from just not just strategic level of application, but also tactical to capture what is happening in season. That's an example of prescription maps. But if you see the low and stable areas, if comparing uniform application versus the variable rate, the yield, there is no leakage in terms, there is no reduction in yield compared to the uniform, but there is a substantial amount of benefits in terms of nitrogen use efficiency. So reduction, again, building ecosystem services, and agriculture needs to become much more, the provider, as yield is a big ecosystem services, along with now avoided emissions and reduction of nitrate leaching. This is an example of a prescription map. So the farmer that joined this program of the 25,000 acres, they have to return to us the as applied map. The as applied map is basically physically a check for a farmer, because they could claim to a registry avoided emissions, because they, if you go from, again, this is an example of one of the application of side dressing. We also place boxes so that farmers, if they need to see the evidence of putting the high rate versus the, and these are very, very large boxes, you know, half acre or so. The benefit of seeing that, again, is critical for farmer, and they can claim the avoided emissions. So that's an example of, to show that if where you put a large amount compared to where it should have been low, but the rest of the field was low, you see that there are basically the yield was consistently low. And so the benefit, which is this point right here, the inherent variability is much greater. So the best predictor of yield is yield, but you have to have an historical understanding and separating the unstable zones, which they fluctuate. They fluctuate given the weather variability, which can also be studied. You can have analogy between years, and you can capture position in the landscape. But in many parts of the world where the field is flat and highly managed, you will only have either high or you have much more stability. If the variability is present in terms of instability, is due to soil depth, which will be easy to detect by having imagery with indices. So just to conclude, you can click on any of this map, and we send the prescription. The synthesis, and so one other question would be for farmers, they haven't adopted this technology yet. They want to know, what if, can I move from conventional tillage to no-till and plant cover crop? How much carbon, how much humic form, the slow organic carbon will I gain? What are the percent change in cumulative nitrate leaching? Those are all the dots where we have farmers' data we fly over and collect. So it's becoming critical. One of the things that I wanted to show as a very quick example, so I'm not doing justice to that, but we strongly believe that the understanding of future genetics, and so in this case, there is greater kernel number, kernel weight, and the efficiency of accumulating resources. So there are several traits that we use that were improved within boundaries that could be possible. And so the impact of future climate in the US, this is strictly for the US Midwest, which is kind of a winner because of more rain in many places. Obviously, you have extreme events which can be wiped out, but the future, the adaptive cultivar would bring benefit. And again, the climate smart commodity is something that is happening in the US. The US government has put $3 billion in incentivizing farmers to do regenerative and climate smart practices. And so one of the things that I work on is on mitigation as well as adaptation. So you go from the stability map to the RX, which is the prescription, avoided emissions, and in relation of the avoided emission, there can be a premium, like we have in Italy, in Europe, for protein, but now it can be in relation to reduction of emission. Now, I know I don't have much time, but I'd like to invite you to read these two papers. One is in PNAS that I recently published, in the next system with some co-authors, and how we go from a linear system to a circular system that emphasizes on electrification, biologicals, improved genetics, partitioning, more carbon to the roots, creating energy on the farm with biodigestion and applying that biodigestate, improving biodiversities, and so on. So with that, I'm going to leave you, obviously, just to show the talented group of people that helped me do this work. And I wanted to thank the agency for funding it. And again, thank you very much for the invitation, and especially Michele for suggesting my name. Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks a lot, Bruno, for the fascinating presentation. We have time for questions. We have two questions from the floor.
Please.
Thank you, Professor, for a nice presentation. I have a short question about, can we move to climate smart agriculture, like we conduct land suitability of crops, and we predict that after 10 years, the climate temperature would be this, and precipitation. Every crop has a specific requirement. So can we move that side, which is the second side of the remote sensing data analysis? Thank you.
Yes, that is correct. I mean, each crop has particular characteristic, and they will perform better under a different interaction between soil and climate. The thing that I would suggest in terms of be able to analyze, what if is to be able to reduce the risk before implementing practices or new crop. There is a role that science and digital system can play, because you will say, what if I plant this crop here? What are my the possibility of the outcome, the probability of obtaining something before implementing? The reason I say this is because too often we have to move away from trial and error in agronomy to say, you do one study, okay, you get a result, and it was a particular year. We can capture historical weather. We can capture the interaction between management, genetics, soils. So that's one contribution that this part of the science that I've introduced plays a critical role.
We have another question.
Thank you, sir, for the talk that you've given. Please, having worked with many rural farmers for many years now, I think one of the experiences I have is to try to bring down climate change to the understanding. Because you keep on saying climate is changing, they say they can't see it. You say the climate is washing away your soil, they say my soil is there. It's just a small portion that is to wash away. So I developed something for my institute with a couple of scientists, that science information should be given to people that are not of your knowing in a very, very low level so that they can imbibe. And also, I don't know what you say about this in the case of AI, because I've tried to look at AI to solve some of these problems for me, especially in rural areas. But limitation of data has been a major problem, because data is the food of AI. And what can you suggest in that way when I don't have data? And also, I try to use carbon credits, the benefit of carbon credits for my sensitization program for farmers, especially that if you do afforestation or reafforestation, that you'll be able to harvest carbon and that you get credit for it. But most of the time they come back to tell me I applied for carbon credits using my afforestation farm or whatever I did, I didn't get a credit for it. So are there sources that this credit can be harnessed I think I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, you raised a very good point. I want to just be immediate to one word that needs to start, floating much more, which is called technodiversity. You cannot, what you've seen today here, it's not transferable in, immediately with the way you would say, in a smallholder farmers. But some of the technology can generate information. Even we can run models and it's the imagery can be flown over anywhere, but they need to be synthesized and be able to be discussed with local stakeholders and people then own the technology. We cannot send technology, imposing technology, thinking that, we know more than the locals and we're going to solve that problem. So it needs to be more dialogue. I'm a physical scientist, obviously, but there is a critical role for social science to work in connection with scientists. Like you said, in be able to synthesize information, what works in one place may very well not work in another. And that's, again, where the digital twin comes in. So there is a level of science in the form ourselves, even of training, some of the local scientists to be able to use these systems in order to have this risk analysis. Now, on the carbon credits, yes, that is going to be an instrument. I just came back 2 days ago from South Africa, and they're selling carbon credits. There are obviously different contexts. They are very large farms in many places. They're trying to push towards the smallholder farmers, but the carbon credit is not a panacea. It's not something that everybody says, okay, I'm going to join. You have to have quite a bit of strict regulation in the sense you have to create additionalities. You have to pull more CO2 or build the sequestration. You have to have some level of auditing and certification. So it's not a simple thing, but I think I can tell you that the world is working towards the possibility of rewarding farmers, even smallholder farmers, to implement practices that are more climate smart. The problem is that building carbon is not necessarily easy in places like tropical soils where it's really, warm. You may not have often, the conditions. So it's a delicate thing. And again, before you embark in this technology, a lot can be known ahead of time.
Thank you. Do we have other questions? No, if not, thanks a lot again, Bruno.
Thank you again very much. I wish you, yes, I hope to see you soon. Bye. And